Before the Lord tonight in prayer, welcome to church and to our last night of our Easter reflection. It's been a journey from Monday till now. I want to believe that the Lord has been ministering to us, and yet it is another evening to have a ministration of His Spirit. So why don't you concentrate on Him in this very second, taking your attention off everything and focusing it on Him. Let everything in you agree with what the single purpose for tonight's gathering, a true moment of intimacy, reliving the moment where the Lord drank of the fruit of the vine with them on earth for the last time and said, I will do this again, but it will be in another place, a more glorious place, a place of amazing glory in my Father's presence. What an honor for us to redo this, experiencing the very life that was bestowed through that occasion. Before you will say anything, I just want everything within you to be so shifted and concentrated on the Lord. He is not in a hurry to hear what you have to say. All He wants is a certain readiness on the totality of you to be concentrated on Him. For this 1.5 hours, that nothing else will matter but Him. Nothing is more desirous but Him. Needing nothing but Him.
I just wanna be where You are, dwelling daily in Your presence. And I don't wanna worship afar.
Yes, Lord.
Draw me near to where You are.
He's here tonight.
I just wanna be
where You are,
dwelling daily in Your presence. And I don't wanna worship from afar.
Yes, Lord.
I just want to be with You. I want to be where You are,
Father Basar,
dwelling in Your presence, feasting at Your table.
And that's what we came to do. We came to feast.
Surrounded by Your glory, in Your presence, That's where I always want to be.
Oh,
I just want to be. I just want to be with you.
Come on, just love him now. Just love him. Just love him. Just tell him how much it is an honor to be at his feet. Tell him how his presence, nothing compares. No friend like his. No friendship like his. Oh, we honor you tonight. We acknowledge your presence. Thank you, you who died and did not remain in the grave. We celebrate you. We lift our hearts and our voices and say we love you. Thank you for this aura of your presence. Come on, speak to the Lord at this moment. Don't let your mind roam at all. Talk to him as a man talks to his friend. At a point, he called his disciples and he called them friends. One of the best names that God ever called Abraham is that Abraham is my friend. Talk to him as a man talks to his friend. The Lord said, were you not afraid to speak about Moses? To the prophets and others, I speak in riddles. But to him, I speak like a man speaks to his friend, face to face. Talk to the Lord face to face. He is real, so make him real in your prayer. Say that I came to love you. I came to be in union with your body and your blood. Inseparable. And he prayed and said, make them one as we are one. Is Jesus and the Father ever separable? No. And he said, my prayer is that they will get to the point where they two in unity are inseparable. Pray finally that the glory of God will descend upon this place. As the worship team, please come up stage. Pray that the Spirit of God, the power of God, takes over this whole service. Through the word that will come, through the songs, through the prayers, through the bread and the wine. The early church upheld this so much that probably the most sacred of all their rites was the moment when they had to break bread. Speak to the Lord, that Lord, give us an encounter in this experience tonight. No more a formality. No more following just a tradition without meaning to me, no. But that which carries all the weight. Thank you, Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Please, can you be on your feet as we rise to praise the Lord this evening? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Eh. Hallelujah. Oh. Hallelujah. Eh. It's the sound of victory. Hallelujah, eh. Hallelujah, oh. Let the sound of rejoicing fill the sound. Hallelujah, eh.
Let's go.
honor this King as you take your seat. You honor him. Every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that only you are Lord. We will also confess, and our knees will also bow in honor of your name. Be exalted tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, I said amen. Once again, you are welcome to our last night of our Easter reflections. And we will finish up with the Bible readings that we began looking at the last week of Jesus. We'll do from Matthew chapter 27, 32 to 66. Our sister Rose Kizzy Hayford will take us through that session. Right afterwards, Uplifters will give us some songs of reflection. And then we will take the words of reflection from our head pastor, Reverend Emisa Esau.
Praise the Lord. Our Bible passage for our reflection this evening shall be taken from Matthew 27, verse 32 to 66. Matthew 27, 32 to 66. I read from the NIV version. As they were going out, they met a man from Cyrene named Simon, and they forced him to carry the cross. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink, mixed with gall. But after tasting it, he refused to drink it. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed the written charge against him. This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Two robbers were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." In the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law and the elders mocked him. He saved others, they said, but he can't save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now, if he wants him. For he said, "I am the Son of God." In the same way, the robbers who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him. From the sixth hour until the ninth hour, darkness came over all the land. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing there heard this, they said, "He is calling Elijah." Immediately, one of them ran and got a sponge. He filled it with wine vinegar, put it on a stick, and offered it to Jesus to drink. The rest said, "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to save him." And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth split and the earth shook and the rocks split. The tombs broke open and the bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs, and after Jesus' resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." Many women were there watching from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee to care for his needs. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. As evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were sitting there opposite to the tomb. The next day, the one after preparation day, the chief priests and the Pharisees went to Pilate. "Sir," they said, "we remember that whilst he was still alive, that deceiver said, 'After 3 days I will rise again.' So give the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he has been raised from the dead. This last deception will be worse than the first." "Take a guard," Pilate answered. "Go, make the tomb as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guard. Amen. Beloved, hear the word of God.
Hallelujah. Tonight we just want to reflect over songs telling us about the death and resurrection of Christ Jesus.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my soul. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depth of sin, when fears are stilled and strife and sin.
Sin, only was there.
praise tomorrow because it lives. All fear is gone. And now I know He holds the future, and life is worth a living just. I can face tomorrow because it lives. All fear is gone, and now I know He holds the future, and life is worth living just.
Jesus Christ, my righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. No, but wholly lean on Jesus' name, on Christ the solid rock I stand, and all at the ground is sinking sand, all at the ground. Precious Redeemer and Friend, who'd have thought that a Lamb would rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, give the healing and grace.
Whoa. Victorious on the cross.
Nimocha.
If we say wedi kuni,
yesha malakota.
Wedi kuni me. Nimocha.
Lepashekota. Lepola pashota.
If we say wedi kuni.
If you know it, you will be on your feet and declare the victory of the Lord. Lepashekota.
If we say wedi kuni,
hemalekotaya,
wedi kuni,
maseteya,
nimoja, wedi, one more time, wedi kuni,
hele basela,
wedi.
Let's continue worshiping. With Yamaka Yina Mami.
Nina Mami. Oh, Mami.
Nimocha.
Wetsiamaka amama de me wo sa
wetsiamaka
nina ma if we say wetsiamaka
and mercies he has redeemed us today. We can confess him as Lord and our Savior.
And you must I say
allow us to die in our sins. Even there were times we confessed Christ and yet we lived in sin. In his mercies, in his grace, he did not destroy us. Today you can confess him as your Lord and personal Savior. Lift up your voice and praise him for that redeeming grace going through all this for you. Bless the name of the Lord. 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 Remember, remember, remember. Remember, remember, remember. When you were slave to that sin, the Lord came to redeem you and to set you free. There are no words good enough. Can we thank you enough for all that you did for us? We cannot. With our lives, with our hearts, with everything we are, we worship you and we bless you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Tonight, we thank God for bringing us together, opportunity for us to reflect through what he went through for us. On that fateful Thursday, many dined with him, the 12 disciples. But after dining with him, they all deserted him along the line, because of human frailties. But for one particular person, even though he ate with the master, he left and hanged himself. Why? Because he followed Jesus with the sole aim of profiting. We learned last time that all he was thinking about, a businessman, to take advantage of situations to make himself rich. Tonight, we are here to encounter the Lord. With all that we have learned in the week, we will dine with the Lord and we will remain in him. Hallelujah. We will not go out there and betray him. We will not go and deny him. We will remain as his children. This evening, we are looking at something Jesus said. Luke chapter 22. I'm reading verse 20. Luke chapter 22. Verse 20, and this is what we hear Jesus say. And likewise, the cup after they had eaten, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood." Is the new covenant in my blood. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 25. We hear the Lord's word through the Apostle Paul say, "In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" We are having a lot of doctrines these days, and I was surprised to hear one preacher preach and say Christianity shouldn't go back to the cross because Jesus is not on the cross. He says Christianity should always focus in heaven because Jesus is sitting on the throne and he's reigning. So there is everything wrong going back to reflect on the cross. But the Apostle Paul made it clear. He said, "When I came amongst you, I did not desire to know anything except Christ and him crucified." And for Jesus, the centrality of our faith and our walk with him is the cross. And this evening, in the few minutes, I just want us to reflect on the theme, the new covenant. The new covenant. Christianity is a religion based on covenant. And it is a covenant we have with our Maker. In God's walk with his people, right from Adam through up to this point, is based on a covenant. It is not the wish of any individual, but a path that is set by the Lord himself and demanding his people to follow.
When we talk about covenant these days, a lot of us will struggle to appreciate it because we live in a time and age where much of the focus is on contracts than covenants. We want to get into contract with people, we sign contracts, we have agreements, and we pursue whatever we want to pursue. So we have come into Christianity also having the mentality of the faith being a contract. Christianity is not a contract, it is a covenant. Hallelujah. Covenant is an oath-bound promise. It's an oath-bound promise whereby one party solemnly pledges to bless or serve another party in some specified way. So we have two parties coming together, and what they do is that they take an oath, a solemn oath, and say, I am going to serve you, or I'm going to provide, I am going to ensure this and that and that and that is done. When you talk about contracts, primarily it is an agreement between two parties to fulfill certain acts. Agreement between two parties. We just want to fulfill an act. So we come together, we write down. But let me mention some three characteristics of contracts and then compare it to some three characteristics of covenant for us to know the faith we find ourselves in and how precious it is to God. When you talk about contracts, they are needed to provide legal parties or legal security where trust is lacking. Where trust is lacking, they are needed to provide legal security where trust is lacking. And underline, trust is lacking. So you come and do something for me, we agree, but some way, somehow, I suspect you. You may do this, you may do that. So let us put it together and let both of us sign. We have a contract. And as a matter of fact, contract can be altered if circumstances change. Is that not it? When circumstances change, we can sit down and look at the contract again, and we change whatever we wrote down. Contracts are intended to protect the rights of the individual. So it's thinking about protecting the right of the individual. But when you talk about covenant, which we are saying Christianity is, we are saying it's a binding or solemn agreement by vows joining two parties together. A divine arrangement based on trust and commitment. Whereas for contract, trust is lacking. For this one, it's based on trust and commitment. And it is divine arrangement. So when two people decide and say, we want to have a covenant, we should know that there is always a divine dimension to covenants people take. And this is supposed to be a caution to our young gentlemen and ladies. You've met that lady, you are so much in love, and you tell her, please let us have a blood covenant, eh? So I want to pierce my finger, and then you also pierce your finger, and then the two thumbs will come together, or the fingers will come together. You exchange blood. Some even go to the extent of putting it in water and drinking. As soon as you do that, spirit possess, because blood is involved. This is nature of covenant. It is an unconditional commitment that is strengthened by adversity. Take note of this. An unconditional commitment that is strengthened by adversity. Whereas for the contract, we say it can be altered. When adversity comes, we are broke. Yes, we decided, give us this money, we will give you this interest. Now, things are not going on well, so come and let us sit down. The interest I decide to give you now, I can no longer give that to you. When people are in contract, that is what we do. But if you are in covenant, in the midst of persecutions and trial, that is where your commitment is made stronger. Hallelujah. A relationship that is characterized by mutual self-sacrificing. I'm saying this to draw your attention to this fact that we have become Christians because of the new covenant which somebody shed his blood on the cross for us to partake and be part of it. Many of us have come into Christianity with the mentality of contracts. So if God does this and things go well and this happen and that happen, then we will also do this and do that and do that. Friends, today we are remembering something special. It is about the blood of our Lord Jesus. It's not a contract. It's a covenant that is strengthened by adversity. When things go tough, the love of God becomes stronger. Hallelujah. When he made this covenant with them, he knew in his heart that they were going to betray him, but he had purpose that even if they betray him, he will still be there and keep them as his disciples. He had already decided to do that. If I wait upon the Lord for months, for years, I cry to him for something and I don't see result, I'm not going to say because I've not seen results, I'm turning my back on God. No. When things are not going the way I expect it to go, that is when my commitment to the Lord ought to be stronger, because the Christian faith is a covenant faith with the Lord. Now, talking about this Lord's Supper that was instituted within the context of the Passover, in Exodus chapter 12, we know the Israelites had been slaves. They had served the Egyptians for over 400 years. And on the day that the Lord wanted to deliver them, the 10th plague, he told them that they should kill animals, use the blood at the doorpost, and that when the angel of death passes and sees the blood, he's not going to enter that house to kill the firstborn. I was just asking myself, but God is sovereign. He could have just shown the angels where to go and where not to go and spare the people. Why did he have to tell them that blood ought to be involved in your redemption? This is what marks us out as Christians from all other faiths and all other religions. We live in a time where we are being told to consider other religions to be the same as Christianity, and saying that Christ is just one of the ways, just as other people are just part to God, as Christ is. But that is not the case. Friends, when we are thinking about the death of our Lord Jesus Christ, we are thinking about a reality. That reality is that man sinned against God and man could not save himself. Man did not have the ability to save himself. But the Bible tells us clearly that unless there is shedding of blood, there is never going to be remission of sin. God is not going to forgive any sin. Other religions will sit down and tell you, count the number of times you do good and the number of times you do wrong. And if the number of times you do good is more than the number of times you do wrong, then you will be saved. And who at all can even fulfill this? God made them use the blood as a shadow of what was going to happen in future to redeem the whole world from the power of the enemy. And so he commanded them that year after year they should come together and commemorate. Eat the feast at his feet to remember that because of the shedding of blood, they were spared and were delivered from the hands of their enemies. So during that celebration, Jesus meets the disciples, and within that same context, decided to institute this Lord's Supper. And the Bible says that he said, this is the blood of the new covenant which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. This is the blood of the new covenant. There was an old covenant. The covenant with Moses. The covenant with Abraham. And for you to become the child of God, you were supposed to have been born by somebody who was in that covenant. But this new covenant we are talking about, you do not need to have a father who is a Christian before you become a Christian. You do not need to become a Jew before God is going to accept you. All you need to do is to believe in the death and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, and you are saved. Praise the Lord. This is what we celebrate as Christians, the new covenant. The old covenant did not have the power to save us. The old covenant did not have the power to make us become justified before God. That is why in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 4, the Bible says it was impossible for the blood of bulls and of goats to take away the sins of men. That was the practice in Judaism when God had instructed them to do. So year after year, the high priest will enter the Holy of Holies, go and offer blood sacrifice, and ask for God's forgiveness for his people. But the blood of sheep and goats could not purge them. The good news that we are celebrating this evening is that somebody died for us. Somebody whose blood knows no guilt. That person died on the cross and we were saved. And before his death, when he gathered his disciples around him, he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin." God knew that man could not save himself. And so in Genesis chapter 6, we hear God says that my spirit is no longer going to contend with man, for he is flesh. If you are counting on your righteousness, if you are counting on anything for you to think that you are saved, this evening I'm here to tell you that your salvation is solely from the new covenant. It's not the covenant of old, but the covenant that is sealed with the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. This covenant we are talking about, we have two parties coming together, and one of the parties is God. God is always committed to his side of the covenant, and he expects us to be committed to the side of our own with the covenant. In Genesis chapter 15, I have shared it here and I'm repeating it. God was making a covenant with his servant Abraham, and God makes Abraham sleep. He first of all instructs him to kill some animals, some birds. Kill them, divide them into two, and spread them. And after doing that, God causes him to sleep. And then he has a vision of smoke coming from heaven on earth, and the smoke moving in between the carcasses on the floor. And while the smoke was moving in between the carcasses, we hear God says, and affirm the covenant he has with him, that with you, all the nations of this world will be blessed. But you see, when God did this, he did it in the context when the people had a certain understanding. What was that understanding? Whenever there was a contract between a lesser person and a greater one, the one who is lesser picks these animals and cuts them into pieces, walks among the carcasses, and make the pledge to his master. That master, if I do not fulfill my part of this covenant, may I be chopped into pieces as these animals have been chopped into pieces. Ask yourself, God coming down to walk among the carcasses and making his pronouncement, trying to tell mankind that for me, whatever I say, I stand by it to the end. This is the blood of the new covenant. I'm here to assure you, the God that we serve is a faithful God. Whatever he says he will do, he will do. Hallelujah. Whatever he has commanded us to do, let us do it, because we will see his glory. We will see his might. He is faithful. He will keep his side. As long as we live on this earth, we have the opportunity to take a decision to live for the Lord. I do not know how you've been living your life. Maybe you've been coming to the Lord's table without having that mentality that this is an issue of life and death. Life and death in the sense that somebody laid down his life and he expects you to lay down your life for him. And when you do it with understanding, you receive the blessings. But when you stay away from the Lord, do what is not pleasing, his favor, his might, his love is withdrawn from you. But as long as we live, this grace and this mercy abound to us. It is only after man has died, that he no longer has the opportunity to come before the Lord. This evening, we are preparing our hearts to dine with him. And I want you to be assured by this, that it is a new covenant. We read in the Old Testament, in Ezekiel chapter 36, God says something very beautiful. The Old Testament, we had a covenant they lived in, and the Lord made promise of a new covenant. We read from verse 25 to verse 26. It says something. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanness, and from all your idols I will cleanse you. And I will give you a new heart, a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh, and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my commandments. This is the new covenant that was promised by the prophets. The Lord says that I will give you a new heart. He knows that with your own strength you cannot. So he says, I'll take away the stony heart and I'll give you the heart of flesh so that you will be able to obey me. You'll be able to follow. This evening I'm here talking to you about the new covenant. It is in the blood of Jesus. The blood that never loses its power. The blood is able to cleanse. And listen to what Ezekiel said. He says, I'll put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. Those who belong to the old covenant never had the opportunity of receiving the Spirit of God dwelling in them. But we have this new covenant that gives us the opportunity of having the Spirit of God dwelling in us. Let us make up our minds to live for this Lord. Let us offer our hearts fully to Him. Let us live our life as people who are in covenant with the Lord, not as people who have contracts. Any point in time you decide to change. God, today is favorable, so I will pray. Today is favorable, so I'll be part of it. Remember that when Jesus was doing this for us, it wasn't favorable. It was difficult. It was tough. He got to a point that, humanly speaking, he felt that God could do something about it. So he pleaded if God could take that cup away from him. This evening, he has done this for us and is inviting us to come and dine with him. Let us open our hearts. Let us be partakers of this new covenant, and we shall forever be blessed by him. Amen. Shall we please close our eyes as we pray and prepare our hearts to dine with the Lord? Thank God for Jesus Christ. Thank God for his saving grace. It's a new covenant. It's able to change us. We sing, I hear your welcome voice that calls me unto thee. 3-5-1. Let's sing it with understanding as the Lord invites us to come and dine with him. Shall we please stand as we sing? last stanza, all hail atoning blood, all hail redeeming grace, all hail the gift of Christ our Lord, our strength and righteousness. I am coming, Lord, coming now to thee, wash me, cleanse me by the blood that flowed on Calvary. The living bread which came from heaven, if anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread which I shall give for the life of this world is my flesh. He was wounded for our transgression. And the response is, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. The Lord be with you. Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is a good and a pleasant thing to do. It is a good and a pleasant thing, our joy and moral duty always and everywhere, to give you thanks and praise. O Lord God, ever living, ever blessed, almighty and all loving, fountain of light and source of goodness, you made all things and filled them with your blessings. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you night and day, and beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name forever, praising you and saying, let's say this together, holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, Lord God, King of the universe, and blessed is your Son, Jesus, our Lord, who on the night in which he was betrayed, he took the bread and looking up to heaven, gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this and eat it. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. Let's say this together. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Hallelujah. Shall we please sit as we pray? Lord, we pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them to be the holy people, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ, to the praise of your name. Amen. Let us say this together. Lord, we come to your table trusting in your mercy and not in any goodness of our own. We are not worthy to gather up the crumbs under your table, but it is your nature always to have mercy, and on that we depend. So feed us with the body and blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him and he in us. Let us go before the Lord in prayer. Prepare your heart as you come to dine with the Lord. Anything that makes you feel unworthy, ask that the Lord will cleanse you. This is the new covenant. Unworthy people believe and they are made worthy. their heart to live in peace with their brothers and sisters, the Lord is inviting you, come to the Lord's table and dine with him. For you, take this and eat. his stripes you were healed. Take and drink, all of you. Jesus broken for you. Take Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you very much. You may take your seat.
Hallelujah. It's been a blessed service, isn't it? I think we can clap for ourselves for our commitment throughout the whole week. Obviously, our number tonight is probably double of the usual one we see. Maybe next year the strategy will be every evening there'll be some small communion and then... But it's a blessing that we've been able to journey from Monday till today. Our time is up. I would have asked what you remember from each of the nights. But if you have forgotten anything at all, remember, we are part of a covenant, not a contract, not that which inconvenience we can go back to God and change the terms. He is faithful to keep his side. We must be faithful as partakers of this covenant as well. Amen. Father, we pray for your servant. Thank you for bringing your word through him. And using him to bring this meal as well. May your strength abound for him, that he will constantly be found faithful in the execution of this privileged work of being your servant in your vineyard. Thank you for his life. In Jesus' name, amen. Our service is drawing to a close. Early tomorrow morning is the Good Friday service. 8:30 a.m. we will be here. So let's do well to be on time. There will be no Bible studies. And so that means the service is likely to be brief. Let's do well to be on time. Sunday, we also meet at 8:30. There'll be a single service. Initially, there was supposed to be Bible studies, but there will be no Bible studies on Sunday as well. So we must do our best to be here. 8:30 a.m. we are present for both Good Friday service and Easter Sunday service. Let's come with hearts prepared as the Spirit of God continues to minister to us through this season. We commemorate the death and the resurrection of Jesus. Let's kindly rise to our feet as we close this service. Gracious Lord, we are thankful for the beautiful moment at your feet from Monday till today. You have chosen to speak to us through various means, making the happenings to you in the last week before you went to the cross a true message to us, to help us to appreciate what you did, but also to serve as an example for us. And when we find ourselves in similar situations, how we can learn from you to respond better. Let these words burn in our hearts continually. That every day as we walk before you, the practice of our faith will be so tangible. It will go beyond just coming for service. It shall be evident in our daily lives, in our workplaces, in our families, in our communities, and the very places where you have planted us. Tonight, as we walk out of here, keep ministering to us. Speak to us in dreams. Those of us who struggle to even catch a sleep, because we have been part of this table of your blood and your body, let it work in us great miracles. Rest to our bodies and our minds. And let us come back tomorrow, hearts prepared, ready to journey with you all the way to Golgotha. That we might die with you, that we might rise with you. Thank you.